Matabililand, near the town of Nkai. So the man's hands are tied behind his back?
Yes.
Tied with wire?
These are two hands, you see? Two of his hands are still tied. Here's the hand.
Yeah. How many bodies do you think are buried here in this pit?
I can't check at the moment, but seeing the pace of a big pit, over 50 bodies may be inside here.
And how were the bodies brought here?
They are just shacked in with the trees and so forth.
And when was this? Was this recently?
About 10 days.
10 days ago?
Yes.
And how were the bodies brought here?
These bodies are brought by some Land Rovers, maybe government trucks.
So you're saying Land Rovers using this old
road, the old crossroad road, turn off and then they come and bury these people. Quite a lot of people are missing in the country, and then we've just found that maybe quite a lot of people, maybe more than 50, can be in here. Understand, there is another pit which is of this diameter around this area.
We've travelled several hundred miles through Matabililand and talked to a wide variety of people in many different villages. Independently, they all confirm the same story. There may well have been incidents here caused by gangs of so-called dissidents. But from what we've seen, we're satisfied that most of the allegations of violence and atrocities are true, are recent, and are still continuing. And as the elections approach, there seems to be no doubt that most of these acts have been committed either by organized gangs of Mr. Mugabe's own political supporters or by certain units of the Zimbabwe National Army. We filmed that mass grave on almost the last day of our visit to Zimbabwe. In the past, whenever bodies have been found here, the government has always blamed dissidents and never the activities of their own troops. Earlier, we'd asked the authorities to let us see for ourselves what the army was really doing in Matabililand.
Can we have your permission to go there and to film what the 5th Brigade is doing?
The 5th Brigade is really not the only unit operating there.
No, I understand that, but we would very much like to, because there's been so much propaganda against the 5th Brigade, we'd very much like to see what they do.
Of course, no. You cannot film our operations. I mean, they cease to have any meaning at all if they are a matter for broadcasting or televising. These are operations we are conducting within secrecy, and naturally the information we get must not be exposed to the public at all.
The beatings, the killing, the torture is unbelievable. Unbelievable. And these people will play it off. People are being taken daily at night, and they disappear forever. And those were taken to police camp in the stops camp in Burawayo. The torture that goes in there is to be seen, to be believed, and by the black people.
The 5th Brigade has only been filmed once at this passing out parade in 1983. It's exclusively Shona speaking, unquestionably loyal to the Prime Minister, and has been trained by instructors from North Korea. In spite of the language difficulties, the Prime Minister has obviously been impressed by the North Koreans. He went to North Korea on one of his first official foreign visits after independence and witnessed many displays of highly organized dedication to the party.
I would like to pay tribute to our comrades in arms the instructors from the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, who with the assistance of instructors from our own Zimbabwe National Army have brought the men under their command to such a high standard.
Two years ago, when this particular film was shot, the 5th Brigade moved into Matabele Land and began a reign of terror. As the elections approach, they've been ordered back again.
Parliamentary democracy, the British legacy to Zimbabwe, should have ended the war. But a two or three party system is neither necessarily the most appropriate for the country, nor does Mr. Mugabe believe in it. When he won the election, he took Mr. Nkomo into government. But he hopes to achieve a one-party state, he says, by agreement. Some think the Matabele Land campaign is part of that plan. Ian Smith, the man who deprived the black majority of their rights for so long, is today deprived of his passport. He believes the government has abandoned its commitment to reconciliation.
They broke their promises with Nkomo and Zapu after Lancaster House. They've driven the Matabeles into a corner. What do you expect the Matabeles to do? I never criticized this government in public, the Prime Minister, and I said to my caucus, well, you mustn't do it because we're trying to help them. We want to get them established. Until they attacked me. Well, in politics, you know, especially in an election time, if your opponents attack you, you must attack them. So they provoke it and then throw up their hands in horror and say, look at the terrible things they're doing to us.
You're saying then the Matabele Land problem is a direct result of government policy?
Well, they're pressurizing them, they're pushing the Matabeles, and it stems from the time, I believe, when Nkomo said that he was opposed to the one-party state. And I know that was when my trouble started with the Prime Minister. We got on very well together. We used to meet regularly. And he said he was pleased to see me because I represented the white people and he wanted to know what the white people were thinking. I was always met very courteously, but then on one occasion I had to tell him, I cannot go along with you and your one-party state philosophy because that will mean the end of freedom to me. And I pleaded with him to stop it because he was destabilizing our whites, more were immigrating. And I knew from my contacts with businessmen overseas that he was prejudicing investment in our country. So those things were bad for the country.
You're suggesting then that Mugabe has decided that if he cannot get a one-party state by consensus, he'll get it by whatever means is necessary.
Well, Mugabe has always denied that he controls dissidents.
Mugabe knows that I'm not that type of man. And he wished I had done it. He wished that there was an attempt against him so that he would have taken authentic action against me. When he failed to do it, he organized dissidents in my name.
The fact that we have not arrested him is purely out of deference to him, that he's old, he has played that part in the past, in the revolution. We would have picked him a long time ago without any qualms.
But two of Nkomo's Zipra generals were arrested, Dumiso Dibengwa and Lucat Masuku. They've been detained for 3 years.
We happen to know that they were responsible for this exercise in hiding these arms. Dumiso Dibengwa went to Zambia and persuaded the Zambians to send the arms to Zapu, to Zipra, rather than to government.
But why haven't you brought this evidence against them in court?
We have, in court he will say, of course, that he never said any such thing. And you know the procedures, the English procedure requires that there should be that clear evidence before you can actually...
But if you can't prove that he's guilty, why do you still...
We can still prove with our own intelligence information that he is guilty, sufficiently guilty to be able to be detained.
Why don't you put him on in front of a court?
We put him in detention for the same reason that you need the technicalities. The procedures that are require that evidence must be sufficient.
We set out at 3:30 in the morning so as to avoid the police roadblocks.
I will shoot the police.
With local help, we were heading deep into Matabele Land, south from Bulawayo, to an area called Antelope. the site of an old concentration camp dating back to the early 1980s when Robert Mugabe was newly in power. We found that most of the buildings had been completely destroyed, but not all. And this one brought back terrible memory,
Some of them, they just shoot, some of them, they beat them until they die. Then they just, you light you off the fire, then you burn until you die. If I remember now, my heart is so painful.
These are the men responsible. The Zimbabwean Army's 5th Brigade. They were trained in killing by North Koreans. Later, Mr. Mugabe referred to the massacres, frankly, as a moment of madness. But at the time, he fended off questions about them.
Wherever you have operations, you're bound to have one or two untoward incidents, but not the mass graves which they talked about. Where are they?
None.
This man knows. He's a surviving member of the 5th Brigade. And we tracked him down.
And we were told that we must kill any ex-Zimba that you find at home.
He explained that they'd been ordered to kill Robert Mugabe's political enemies. He had personally murdered people at the camp we'd been to at Antelope. And he told us what they'd done with the bodies, thrown them down a nearby mine shaft. We headed off there. And you can just see the buildings on the side of the road with some people standing in front of it. We had to be very careful here because this entire area is controlled by a militia which is loyal to Robert Mugabe. Getting there was a tense business. At the mine head, we lowered our camera down the shaft to see if the bones still lay at the bottom. But they'd been reburied in the bush close by a few years ago in order to hide the traces of the massacre. An old man had watched as the new graves were dug, and he showed us where they were. According to a Catholic commission which investigated the massacres in Matabele land, at least 20,000 people died altogether. Back in Bulawayo, we went to see the former Catholic Archbishop who had courageously protested about the killings. Did he, I asked, think that Robert Mugabe was responsible?
I believe, because who can give orders? And who brought the North Koreans in to train their soldiers for killing? And the soldiers from Mugabe sent them to kill. So, I mean, I believe.
Matabele land was Zimbabwe's killing field. But will anyone be brought to trial for what happened here? Not necessarily.
After all, the main reason why Robert Mugabe and his closest associates have clung to power so fiercely has been their fear that they'd spend the rest of their days in prison. Maybe a new government here might think that it was better to mend a broken society by forgiving Robert Mugabe rather than by punishing him.